Hi everyone, I've been reading really slowly this summer, but I did read these three books that to me, even though in different ways they're not ostensibly about these topics, made me think a lot about parents. The first book was What It Means When a Man Falls from the Sky by Lesley, Nneka, Arimah. That is a short story collection. It's absolutely beautiful. I think it's her debut, which is astonishing. Debut, that's rude. The second one we're going to talk about is The Road to Lichfield by Penelope Lively. This was one I'd never read. Penguin actually sent this to me because it's been reissued with this beautiful new cover. And it was one of those books that I thought, I know the author, I love the author, and it's going to be a quick read and quite light probably. And of course it wasn't. Of course it was devastating in quite a lot of ways. And the third book, which I received from a friend who works at Riverhead, is Refuge by Dina and Nayeri. And I've been waiting to talk about this until this comes out because this is one of my favorite books of the year. I can't exactly put my finger on why, but the voice and the back and forth between these various narratives really just got to me in some of the most, like, it just clawed down like a cat and then the claws went in underneath me, you know? Yeah, so these are all quite different books. Refuge is the story of Nilu and her father. Nilu is an Iranian girl who lives in America and grows up in America. She's trying to work out who she is. She's trying to understand her immigrant identity, but she's also a very high achiever within this Western context and how to fit herself in that and fit herself in the lives of others. The things that she still chooses to protect. She has a thing called a perimeter where she keeps all of the essentials that she would need in case there was an emergency and she needs to flee. And her dad back home is not someone she sees very often. And every time she sees him, she has these very limited interactions with him. You see his exchanges and what his day-to-day life is like. In all of the stories that I'm going to talk about today, there is often a physical distance that obviously represents a greater kind of distance, but also a distance of language, an inability to communicate across that great divide. Sometimes you just don't have the words to speak to your parents. On other precious occasions, there is of course this language, both of words and of memories that you communicate to each other with. This was also in many ways quite a contemporary look at the refugee crisis and the globality of it. The specificity of each individual person's experience, but also the huge, colossal scale of it and the responses refugees receive in communities, especially European ones. In many ways, this was a novel about expectation of your parents, expectation of your futures, an expectation of how you will be treated by others. I have misspelt the title of this book so many times while talking about it over the past month or so, but The Road to Lichfield is about Anne Linton, whose dad has suffered a stroke. Oh hey, light reading, just exactly what happened to your dad. And so she travels from her suburban bubble and all of the local village gossip with the local village neighbours with their agendas and how her own fit into that. And she travels to Lichfield, where her father's old house is, and he's now in a home. He's extremely confused. He's mixing her up with someone else. And through that, she learns a history of her father's, but then also a little bit about herself. I would say it's a novel about the capacity of those we love to betray us. And then of course about that distance. I mentioned the communication and the language of memory before, but what about those memories you haven't shared, where the picture doesn't quite fit and the puzzle doesn't quite work because you're coming from a different set of experiences. Also through our parents, we have a sense of ourselves, what our own limits are, what our moral boundaries are, because our parents are the people who a lot of the time would have introduced us to those concepts at the very beginning. So when you see them not living up to those concepts, when you see them living their lives in different ways, that in itself feels like a different kind of betrayal, but also confusion, because these bright lines suddenly become quite blurry and hazy. What It Means When a Man Falls from the Sky is one of the most stunning short story collections that I have read in quite a while. I think it's received a bit of acclaim. I hope so, because it's absolutely brilliant. How many stories are there? Let's count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. There are 12 short stories in here. I'm also for a moment gonna do the BookTuber thing and show you the underside because I think it's such a beautiful shade of green. While Refuge and The Road to Lichfield are realistic in the way that we think about realistic fiction, this is definitely more magical realism. Some of them are slightly more infused with the otherworldly than others, but all of them really ring true. When I saw the title of this collection, I thought it was going to be predominantly about men and women, or men seen through the eyes of women and lost love and all of that. And it is kind of like that, but it is mostly about parents and children and sisters too. There are many accounts in these stories of a parent's first betrayal. You expect them to be on your side, as it were, not necessarily in the small things, but in the big things that really matter to you and protecting what you want to protect because you can't quite protect them yourselves. Saying it in that way makes me think that a lot of the time, when we ask our parents to help us protect something, we are really asking them to help us protect ourselves, but we don't quite put all of that together because we don't see ourselves as independent or as vulnerable enough to need protecting, but we still have those feelings and those attachments and that feeling that something is valuable to us and that we need to look after. We don't quite have the language to talk about it. It talks about those betrayals. It talks about the great lengths parents will go sometimes, but then also all the places where we all fall short. And in a couple of these stories, gossip also comes into play. And that was something that really lit something up in my mind. Linked to that idea of betrayal, I remember feeling so upset when I realized that my parents were talking to other people's parents about me, sometimes in a negative way, or like sometimes in a way of, here's this funny thing that my child did today. And for some reason, I found that very hurtful because I suppose it lines in with that idea of your understanding of yourself and your understanding of your parent is on your side in that sense of yourself. And when they're not, I mean, you don't feel that they're on your side, you also don't feel like they're necessarily actively going against you on a broader scale. Like your fights and your confusion and your conflict is local, but when it feels broader than that, that feels like betrayal. You've taken this private thing and you've made it somewhat public. That was something I hadn't thought about for a long time, especially as you're in this point of learning about what it means to be private and public and that tension between those spaces, if they can be so clearly boundaried. With Refuge and what it means when a man falls from the sky, especially, there was a lot of talk about, you know, combination of cultures and being from an immigrant culture, or finding that strange medium between the two where you had to perform and code switch and so on. For me, as someone growing up in a family with an immigrant mother and a father from the country I was growing up in, there was a strange confusion, I think, between that private and public space and what is your own private space, what's your family private space and your public space, which I think in British culture is quite extremely boundaried. It's very strict in many ways and what you don't talk about with other people and where those things don't cross over. But in Mexico, it functions in a different way a lot of the time. Private is more public and public is more private, and the crossover there was something that I had to translate in its role in my personal life in the UK, because my home was a mix of all these different kinds of private and public life, not in any extortionate kind of way, not in any exploitative kind of way, but just in the way we have interactions with our close family and our friends and what it means to have close family, because I think that that's a concept that is also quite British, you know, that the idea of family being limited in some way, being contained to this nuclear set, is just not what I see when I go to Mexico and you have all sorts of aunts and uncles and cousins coming over and they are all as much part of your family, which I think is brilliant. But it just means that this confusion of yourself, and also I think of the role that you feel like your parents serve, is muddled in some way. So those are some thoughts I had on those books, yes, but then also on the idea of parents and home and what it means to grow up in different places, whether that's physical or cultural, or both. Let me know your thoughts and comments, and I'd also love to hear your recommendations for any books, films, TV shows, etc., that you feel like represent parents in an interesting way, especially if there's a distant relationship there, some kind of barrier that cannot quite be crossed. I'm going to do the thing. Please like the video, subscribe. You can find a video that YouTube has picked out for you right here, and here's one that I picked out for you as well that I thought you might like. Speak to you soon. Bye.